What's up, man?
What's going on?
How are you?
I'm good. I was hoping you were going to be naked in the sun with your headpiece.
I'd like to be, but it's kind of snowy out there.
Well, cool. I'm good with just getting right to it if you are.
Yeah, man.
All right. Well, I guess we'll test my reading skills by me reading that introduction email you sent me. So, this is Danimal from the RawBrahs. Welcome to our next podcast video interview. I am here with someone that I am definitely excited to be interviewing, named another Danimal, named Daniel Vitalis. And Daniel Vitalis is a leading health, nutrition, and personal development strategist. Encouraging us to rewild ourselves, he teaches that invincible health is produced by a life aligned with our biological design. His entertaining, motivational, and magnetic delivery style has made him an in-demand public speaker in North America and abroad. He is the creator of findaspring.com, a resource helping people find fresh, clean, wild water wherever they are, and the founder of Surthrive, a brand pioneering a lifestyle of health and adventure. Daniel was recently featured in the widely acclaimed film Hungry for Change, and he can be found at danielvitalis.com.
Well done, Danimal. And I know doing the podcasting thing, I'm constantly reading people's bios, and it's like sometimes I read them and I'm like, man, I know this person is so much more than this like paragraph can. Interesting to try to sum yourself up in, 100 words.
Well, it does a great job. I definitely want to honor you for coming up with that. And I really like the I like your play on words because I think we definitely have that in common. Like, we have little things, fun, comfortable, placations. So I like your Surthrival and rewilding.
Yeah, you got to be able to play with the language, and it's a Latin root language, which means it's made to be sort of modular. I think we should take advantage of
So what does modular mean?
like it can be changed around, like all the parts are changeable,
Yeah, I
right?
like listening to your podcast just because, for several reasons, but one of them is my vocabulary seems to increase after listening to them. So thank you for another vocab word of the day there.
Sure, thank you.
And speaking of your introduction, find a spring. I recently used that to find a spring in Georgia, Indian Springs.
Cool. Haven't been there.
Oh man, it was according to your website that it's one of the top 10 healing springs in the United States, and it's definitely it was awesome. I went there on a kind of a semi-fasting day where I don't think I had eaten anything, just drank, and I actually indulged a little bit on the sacred herb before going there, which I guess we'll get to because that's what your recent dispatch is about.
Cool.
But I noticed I might have been a little more in touch with things than usual. But man, that water really like nourished me. And I think going in with an empty stomach and being in that maybe a little bit of a different dimension, I could really get in touch with that. So I would love, I know you could probably speak all day about water, but what is going on there? Why was I so nourished from that water? And
Yeah. Wow. I mean, well, thanks for using the website. And of course, all that database is built by the users. So I don't get to go to every one of those springs or test them out. Maybe someday I'll take that on, but I haven't done that. So I guess looking back over, geez, it's been quite a few years I've been talking about water. I'd say 3/4 of a decade I've been kind of talking about that topic. And so from the big picture, what I see is that the water that comes out of springs is just both chemically and structurally different than the water that comes out of the tap or out of a bottle. So there's stuff going on there that just isn't going on in the water most people are used to drinking. One of the things is, and this is super simple, man, if we took a glass of fresh water, hopefully it wouldn't look anything like that, but if we took a glass of fresh water and we just left it in the sun, man, you'd see little bubbles would form all over the sides of that bottle. You've seen that, right? You just leave water out in the sun, leave a glass, and you get these little bubbles against the glass on the inside. That's the water going flat. That's it's losing its carbonic acid. So literally it's giving up its carbonation. So even though you don't notice when you drink water from the spring that it has carbonation, it does. It's subtle and it gives a taste flavor profile that makes your mouth go like, ah, quench. And if I hand you a beer and all of it's gone totally flat, you'd go like, ugh. If I handed, not that you drink this, but if I handed you a soda and you drank that and it was flat, you'd be like, we like it when the bubbles are there. And when the bubbles go away, we call it flat and we know it's no good to drink now. Well, water is the same way. And so when it goes through the tap, when it goes through filtration for bottling, all those bubbles are taken out of it. So that's one of the things, that the water's flat that people are used to drinking. So you go to the spring and the water is like alive, right? It's not still water, but it's bubbly water at a subtle level. So that's one piece. Another piece is that there's minerality to that water that most of us aren't used to if we're drinking bottled or filtered water. So that's another piece. There's this whole thing that's like barely been really, the surface has barely been scratched on, but that's the idea of structure to water. And essentially that the water molecules line up in natural formations that are different from how it does when it's been forced through like a pipe. So that water is hydrating you in a different way because your body receives structured water differently than it receives unstructured water. So I'll say this to people very often. It's like if I take a piece of writing that's really good and then I break it down into all the letters and I just hand you all the letters, you can take those letters, but you can't really decipher the original meaning that they were assembled into, because it's the not the letters, it's not the ingredients, it's the structure of the ingredients. So unless I put those ingredients, those letters in the right structure, you'll never get that piece of writing again. Therefore, the meaning can't be received. So when you get water that comes from the earth, it's put together in such a way that your body receives it, like information, as opposed to if I force it through man-made filtration or bottling, you take that water and it's like, body goes like, oh, this is okay. I'll stay alive, but I'm not going to be like zinging and awake and refreshed from it. So that's been my experience. And so most people report the same thing. That's what's interesting, is like people go to springs and they come back and they tell this story you just told me. I've heard 1,000 times more than, I mean, I've heard probably 10,000 times. Like, wow, what's up with that? I went to the spring, I drank the water, I felt so refreshed and alive. It's like, whatever that is, that's nature, that's creation, that's the reality of this earth. And we've been living in this like horrible factory farm where the water sucks.
Yeah, definitely got me stoked on springs. And because I travel so much that it actually, now I have a new thing to add to do to my travels. Like now I can check that website. It used to be like checking surf spots, which it still is, but now I can add, are there any springs near this surf spot? And I've actually got to check out a few on some recent journeys. And yeah, that I have drank, just to clarify, I had to have drank soda. And I don't always drink beer, but when I do, it's good beer.
Want it to be bubbly.
And that was a good metaphor to that.
And yeah, you know, surfing, you must know, man. It's the water is important, but the energy in the water is what makes the wave. And so you want both, right? Surfing is about riding the energy through the medium of the wave, through the medium of the water. It's not just the water. So there's like, to get the surf, you need water plus energy. And when you're at the spring, there's water, but there's also this energy to the water. And that energy has dissipated by the time people get it out of their tap or the time they get out of their bottle. I mean, I think that's so obvious.
Yeah, it's actually, it probably changed my life actually in a way, because I've been traveling, I've been nomadic for about 7 years now. And I keep building up things in my mind. Like, well, if I do decide to live somewhere, I'm gonna need waves. I'm gonna need a waterfall. I'm gonna need like a place, which I'll get to next. I kind of alluded to earlier, where I can be naked in the sun. And now I think I'm gonna need a spring nearby. Is that have anything to do with where you've chosen to live? Do you have like a spring in your yard?
I have a spring, but not as close as I'd like. I have to go down the road a bit. But I haven't. I also have been pretty nomadic and haven't really settled into a place either. So I'm kind of still scanning the earth for my spot. You know, assuming there's a spot for me. And that's basically a requirement of it, is that I need a spring on that piece of property. So, but yeah, for me, wherever I live, that's really important that there's spring water nearby. And it's a real challenge for me to go to places like where we last saw each other, I think it was Los Angeles, right? Mm-hmm. It's really challenging. There's just not a lot of good water there. Now, people are really kind to me and they'll bring me water from outside the city when I go places like that, which is really beautiful. But for me, if there isn't, I just think there's this really bizarre thing going on Earth right now where people, you know, because when you think about it, people are made of water, you know, almost complete, yeah. Right? If we were going to do like law of averages, people are made of water, and yet some people live in places where there's no water, which means that their bodies are made out of essentially some kind of stolen or borrowed water. And that is just a bizarre idea, like that you could go to Vegas and you have all these water bodies walking around, but the water isn't from there. So they've taken it from somewhere else and brought it there so that they could live there. It's kind of strange.
Yeah, that is interesting. And on that note, I mentioned a few things that I've been scoping out. What about you? Is there other, you said the same thing, you might be looking, I don't know, for me, if I ever have children in the future, I want, like what I said, I want to have a waterfall, the sunshine, a place where I can get naked, surf, spring. Are there any other things that you're looking for when you're scanning the earth?
High ground is really important.
High ground.
So, you know the feeling, it's so interesting when you're down, where I live right now, I'm kind of down in the forest, and there's some benefits to that, but I don't have the ability to like see out over big distances. So what I notice is after a couple of days of that, I start to get like really kind of stir crazy. I need to get up on top of a hill and be able to see. That feels so good to me, especially when I can see to the south, because then at night I have access to the night sky. So southern exposure with a hill is on a hill is really one of the big important pieces for me. And then, yeah, in addition to the spring, having moving water is really important. Or just water. I'm open to lakes. I'm open to ponds. I'm open to, you know, creeks and streams, but definitely having water is pretty crucial. And a good chunk of forest or whatever kind of natural habitat is that place, because I like the desert too.
There's not many nomadic elitists out there that I know that I can have this conversation with, so it's definitely a pleasure chatting about this craziness. What were you saying?
Aristocratic nomads. yeah, you know, what was it? I think it was Frank Herbert, the guy who wrote Dune, said something about every revolutionary is a disguised aristocrat. But anyway, I do have lists of the things that I'm looking for in a property. So I think similarly, you know, my girlfriend and I just constantly keeping track of like, okay, we also want this. And it's causing us to really narrow in on the place because the amount of filters is so high now.
Speaking of that, have there been places that, like, areas in the world? Is there, like, a place in Costa Rica? I don't want you to give away your actual land location, but are there specific spots on Earth that are vibrating at a frequency that could be the perfect spot for you?
I really like some aspects of New England, and then I really like aspects of Sedona, Arizona. That area I really like, too, that Flagstaff, Sedona area. So those are the two places I've looked the most.
Okay, cool. Good to know. I heard somewhere on, I think it was on a Facebook post that Mark Zuckerberg might have just bought like 700 acres on Kauai, on the north shore of Kauai.
Yeah. Yeah, man, I'm not a super tropical character. I notice I always see pictures of you sort of abbed out under a waterfall, like somewhere. yeah, not really my gig, but I do. I mean, obviously it's beautiful there. That'd be like third home maybe.
Cool. Abbed out. Good transition. I know you're a fan of being naked in the sun as well.
Yeah.
You want to explain a little bit what it is about that for you?
Yeah. Well, I mean, the foundational background to this would be my sort of overarching philosophy is that when human beings made this transition from living as a wild creature to living as a domesticated creature, this is about 10,000 years ago, we initiated a sort of domino effect, downward spiral kind of trend in our health and in our happiness. So just about everything we've done to change our role as one of the wonderful apes of the planet has been detrimental to us. And one of the things that's really bizarre is that we actually harm ourselves with clothing, you know? So we wear it all the time, and yet we know that we need this sun exposure on our naked skin. I mean, it's really, really important to us. So for me, one of the criteria, just like you mentioned, I believe if I'm not living in a place where I can walk outside naked without having to like look around first or, you know, make sure the neighbors aren't home or something like that, then I need to move to a place where I can do that, because I think that's just basic human freedom. So I do it. One, I need the sun exposure and it's really healthy for me. But for all of us. But two, because it's fundamental to being human, there's this crazy idea that there's something immoral about nakedness, or there's something wrong about nakedness, or there's something inherently detrimental to others, like as if it will create sexual, you know, tension for them, or it'll create sexual desire, or then there's something wrong with that. Like there's something wrong with our bodies. It's really strange. It's like I don't see my dog having any issues with any other dogs because they're naked, right? And she doesn't hump more because the other dogs aren't wearing clothes or something like that. You know what I mean? It's so strange. Like what are we still worried about? But anyway, you know, it obviously we wear clothing at times because of climate and temperature, but really we need more naked sun exposure for our mental health and for our physical health. So yeah, I mean, right now where I'm living, it's, as you can see, it's snowy cold right now. Yeah, so I'm not out there under the gray sky, but most of my season I do all my stuff outside naked.
Yeah, I even feel differently, like, to get a little more specific, when I can actually put my genitals in the sun, I almost feel a different energy than when I'm just shirtless. And I've actually thought about yoga, like, when I'm not a huge yoga person, but I see people doing yoga, and I'm like, man, that'd be really good if I did that in the sun, because then I would get sun everywhere.
You know, when your testicles get, like, sun exposure causes men to produce more testosterone. But there are certain areas of your body that cause increased testosterone production over other areas. And one of those areas is your testicles. So when your balls are in the sun, your testosterone production goes up, which makes you feel great, right? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I'd agree. But also those are areas of our body that have been chronically sun-starved. So that's another interesting thing. I get the opportunity to bring a lot of people over the years to retreats where there's nudity in certain areas. And so I see all these bodies, you know, from all over the world and of really cool people. So not, these aren't, you know, it's not like we pulled up to McDonald's and we grabbed a couple of people and we stripped them down. I mean, these are people living really cool alternative lifestyles. But you get most of them naked and they have extreme tan lines somewhere or really, 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 really bright white bums, you know? So my thing is, like, I don't want to have any tan lines, right? Tan lines are like a pathology. So they indicate that you've starved a part of your body of a nutrient. So, so yeah, I agree. And I think probably your genitals and your butt need more sun than everywhere else because they've gone so long without it, right? Most of our lives.
Yep. And that brings me to another idea. The other night for Thanksgiving, I had some duck. And I rarely eat duck. But something about that felt good. I felt like maybe once again like a testosterone thing. And I'm wondering, just like you're saying that for some people's butts or balls could be starved for the sunshine, what do you think about like variety of foods? Is it possible my body was craving something inside that duck?
Duck. That's a good question. Well, variety is really crucial, man. And at least it appears to be crucial when we look at our indigenous diet. So again, background philosophy being, if we look at indigenous people, we can get some sense of our sort of zoology. The unfortunate mistake people are making is they're trying to base diets off of other people who are domesticated. So it's just kind of a roundabout, right? So it'd be like dogs trying to figure out the optimal diet by studying other dogs when they could just look at wolves where they come from and see what wolves eat, and then they could go like, oh, that would make the most sense. So for us, it doesn't make sense to be like, well, what do they eat in China? Who cares what they eat in China? They're domesticated in China too. We need to look at what hunter-gatherers eat because that's what we have been throughout our entire history. And then we can kind of piece together a diet. When we look at that, we see they eat a tremendous variety of food, far beyond orders of magnitude past what we're eating. So most of us only get access to this really small, limited range of foods. And when it comes to animals, what do people eat? They eat beef, they eat pork, they eat chicken. You know, not a lot of variety, some fishes maybe, but ancestrally we would have had access to a huge variety. And of course, duck is really nice, man. It's a really fatty bird, right? Dark, fatty meat. In contrast to, let's say, chicken, which is this hyper-domesticated, awfully hybridized animal who scarcely resembles its wild ancestor anymore and whose meat is so devoid in fat that, I mean, it's kind of like sawdust, right? So, of course, like, duck felt nice.
Yeah, and on a quick note about chicken and duck, first of all, I've had some duck eggs recently. Totally different egg, like, 3 times the yolk size and, like, barely any white.
Hard, thick shells.
Yeah, which says something. And then for chicken, I notice when I do eat chicken, I always want, like, the organs and the skin and the fat. Like, I have very little interest in the white meat.
Yeah, have you ever heard of this idea of, I think what they call it, like rabbit poisoning or rabbit starvation. You ever heard of that?
I don't think so. But
it's a sort of meme in the survival world. So I hang out in the survival world a lot or whatever. But there's this meme about if you just eat rabbit, like if you're in a place where all you're hunting is rabbit, that eventually you can end up sort of starving to death. intoxifying your kidneys. Now, I don't know if this is fully true or not, but the idea is there's not enough fat in a rabbit. It's too lean, right? Like squirrels like that too. It's all white meat. Now, the reality is that's not totally true. If you ate the whole thing, like the liver, like the heart, like the skin or parts of the skin, like the brain, you would get enough fat. But the idea is if you just eat the meat itself, it's just too lean. So you're just eating protein and you're not getting fuel. And if you burn just protein as fuel, of course, it's kind of kidney toxic. So anyway, with chicken, it's like if you're not eating the skin, and of course skin is an organ, right? But if you're not eating the skin, another thing with chicken that I like to do, but this will kind of gross out people at my table sometimes, is I break off the condyles on the end of the bones. You know that knobby bit? I break that right off and eat that, and then I'll crack the bones and actually scrape the marrow out of there. That's real fatty, right? That balances the meat back out. Of course, that's true of the liver and the heart, but they're so little. So yeah, this is an animal that also, let's keep in mind, that's not like, this isn't how that animal was created or how it was evolved or however people like to think about that. That's an animal shaped by humans. So it's like, it's like the difference between a wolf and an American bulldog. The American bulldog was made by people, and the chickens we're eating today were made by people. They are not the guinea hen or the jungle fowl that come from Indonesia. They're changed by us to have way too much meat. So yeah, they're not that palatable, I don't think.
Yeah, I know. Speaking of rabbits, we could probably get down any rabbit hole here. And I didn't have an exact structure of this, so I guess we'll let whatever organically unfold happen. But one thing I do want to hear from you is, because I know you've been doing these podcasts, which I've really enjoyed. I think that's kind of what got me into doing podcasts, taking these drives, and I can become so educated. Yeah. Or educated. Actually, one of my friends recently told me that she's a doctor in Canada, and she was saying how she's starting to feel like education is a form of domestication. And I thought that you might resonate with that. But I'm just curious, let me know if this is how the format's been. You first had a dispatch on diet, then fitness.
For people listening, my magazine is called Rewild Yourself. It's free on danielvitalis.com. And instead of calling it issues, I call them dispatches. And the first dispatch was called The Intrinsic Taboo, actually. That was like a big picture, hey, it's taboo to talk about domestication and human wildness.
Okay.
And then I did one on food. Then I did one on movement, which was really, really fun for me. I really liked that one. Then I did one on operant conditioning and how dog training essentially works on people too, and how our civilization has been using dog training to educate us, essentially. We were educated under a dog training model in our public school system. Let's see. Then I did one on, I think the next one would be on sex. Then I just did one on drugs. So those last two have been really edgy, pushed a lot of buttons for people.
And I'm curious, because we're maybe sort of similar, we get exposed to all kinds of information, but like off the top of your head or from your heart right now, what have been, like, out of all those interviews you did, what were some of the most like paradigm shifting for you, or what was some of the most like, wow, I'm still thinking about that part of that interview with that specific person? Have there been any highlights that stick out to you right now?
Yeah, well, as far as being most important, I think the interview I did with Elena Timetti, and so people know, I have a podcast called Rewild Yourself, but what I'm doing is I first interview everybody on a subject that's going to go in the magazine, and then I time release those out on iTunes. So if you've been listening to the podcast, you'll notice, wow, it's like the same theme for a couple of episodes, and then it changes. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's been like that. I interviewed Elena Timetti when we talked on, I think it was issue 3, where I was talking about how our minds get programmed. And with her, we discussed birth trauma. She's sort of the expert on birth trauma. And that one is, for me, really, really powerful. The impact, it's just so amazing how much we've underestimated the first moment of your life on Earth, how important that is to shaping your experience of the gestalt of what this life is. Right? If your first experience was coming out into candlelight with a harp playing and beautiful naked goddesses who are the midwives gathering you in their arms as they pass you to your mother and your father's there holding her and there's all this love, that's going to impact how you see the world. That's your first formative experience of what this life is. If your first experience was in a stark white fluorescent lit hospital being pulled with forceps or a vacuum out of your mom who's paralyzed from the waist down and then rushed off to be stuck in an incubator and never get to connect with your mother during that really intense oxytocin rush that should have been there that bonded you two together, and dad's in a crack house down the street and they're fighting, that's going to have an impact on what you think this world is like, right? Of course.
For sure.
And
for sure.
Anything in between. So Elena talks about how, you know, every birth is traumatic at some level, but some are particularly traumatic and then they shape us. And my experience is that when you're born in the hospital setting, it imprints in your mind that the hospital is this really important place, one. You know, I liken it to when like this idea of ducklings who are first hatched and there's no mama duck around and they follow around the dog or they follow around a person because they just imprint on the first being they see. Most of us, the first being we saw was a doctor. That's the first being you see is a doctor. So of course, later in life, whenever something goes wrong, where do we run back to? We don't run back to the doctor, right? To the hospital. And our first experience of life doesn't feel like planet Earth, but feels like a spaceship. Because that's what most birth wards feel like, right? They're not even like natural environments at any level. So anyway, this impacts us and imprints us. And that the talk with her really blew my mind. Also, I discussed circumcision with sort of the leading expert on that topic. And that's another just world rocking subject. I mean, in the United States, we still mutilate the genitals of boys to keep them from masturbating. It's pretty shocking.
Yeah, I'm happy you brought that one up. And that's actually, I haven't listened to all the podcasts, but I think the one I started with is the guy you're speaking of. Is he a doctor or what's his?
Dr. Goldman. He's a doctor of psychology.
Okay.
I think his first name off the top of my head, but his last name is Ron Goldman.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Yeah.
That kind of blew my mind because I've been on this journey of really getting in touch with the way I feel and my emotions. And I think it's actually, it's almost a gift that I can be, we have these retreats that we do a lot of like crazy emotional breakthroughs. We co-facilitate this process where people really put it all out on the line. And somehow I have this ability to stick with people logically and rationally. Whereas someone else, like my wife, she'll start feeling their pain and she'll lose it too. And when he spoke about that bris, the bris ritual, all of a sudden something happened to me where I was like about to cry.
And are you circumcised?
Yeah, from a bris. And I talked to my parents about it, and it sounded like it was almost the same exact situation that he painted. So now I've been on this like, whoa, what? Yeah. Maybe this is something here.
That first comes up, it's like, man, because it's so interesting. It's like there's like resistance at first, like, oh, it's not a big deal. Like, yeah, they cut off part of my penis when I was a 3-year-old baby. Not a big deal. Actually, pretty big deal, right? Then it's like, if somebody talks about it like that, it's like, and you connect to it, it's like, can be kind of emotionally vulnerable. And then there's like a lot of anger, for me at least, there's been a lot of anger of like, not only that this happened to me, but that it continues to happen right now. And again, there's another one happening. And right now, another one's happening. There's little boys out there having their foreskin crushed off. I mean, this is just shocking. So yeah, I mean, I think one of the really powerful things he mentioned in there was that when you start to connect to how you feel about it, there's no resources to go to, really. If you go to a therapist right now and say, hey, I want to talk about my circumcision trauma, likely the therapist is circumcised and in denial about his feelings about it, so he can't even assist. You know what I'm saying? There's like very few people who've gone through the process of actually connecting emotionally to any of this.
Yeah, and I'm still open to trying to figure it out. Have you figured anything out for yourself?
How do you mean
to deal with this? To like maybe get maybe more closure on it or more conversion to it. Like,
yeah. Oh well, I mean, I think a big part of it is just really getting real with yourself about how you feel. And yeah, like as far as like, I don't know about getting over it, but essentially making peace with it has been my. I think at first I would look down and be like, oh my God, that's my penis has a huge scar on it. A scar that I think most men and women think of as being natural and anatomical. So, you know what I mean? We see that ring, that kind of dark.
Oh yeah, I know what you mean.
We just think that's part of the penis. And it's like, no, that's a battle wound. It's a huge scar.
Well, it really gives a peephole into the matrix when you talk to the women from the United States and that's what they prefer. Like, well, I would prefer my child to have that because that looks better. So then it really becomes obvious there is something going on here that we need to talk about.
What's going on here, right?
Yeah.
And it's funny, too, because they've obviously had – we've had a lack of exposure to natural penises in this culture. I saw a great video. I don't know if you caught this one. But it was a video on circumcision, and they go up to this group of girls, and they go, hey, girls, does this penis look weird? And then they show them a circumcised penis, and they're like, yeah. And they're like, does this penis look weird? And they show them a picture of an uncircumcised penis, and they're like, yeah, all penises look weird.
Man.
They do. They all look weird. But, yeah, it's funny that in – I guess it's a perpetuated thing. I think the obvious thing on this topic is like, when you cut the equivalent part of a girl, it's called female genital mutilation. And there's a long history of it. So it's not like, oh, nobody does that. The Muslims do that. Or some Muslims do that. And some Jews cut the penis. Most Jews cut the penis. So you've got the Jew, so you've got this funny thing, right? So out of the whole world of monotheism traces its origins back to the same story, right? The Abrahamic tradition. Right, that's where the whole thing kind of kicks off. It goes all the way back, right? One half splits off and starts mutilating the girl's genitals, and one half splits off and mutilates the boy's genitals, right? Right now, in the Christian world, which follows its lineage through the Jews, they believe that they should continue with the Jewish tradition, but the Muslim tradition should be a world crime, right? So it's now it's like an international crime to cut a girl's genitals, but the cutting of boys' genitals is like this sacred cow that no one will touch. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like we just kind of, it's the Jewish tradition because we're a Christian culture and we trace our Old Testament through the Jews, then we're not touching that. We're just going to not talk about it. It's taboo to talk about. But because we have a war against the Muslims right now, then genital mutilation of girls is illegal. So it's so obvious they're the same thing and that both should be illegal.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting because I come from, being born, my dad's side is Jewish, my mom's side is Christian, and I do consider myself a follower of Christ. Maybe not like most Christians would be, but I don't see the need, being Christian, to mutilate a future child. It actually is very clear in the New Testament, and I don't want to turn this necessarily into a religious debate, but... And my faith is like the grace of Jesus being the ultimate sacrifice of my Savior. And it's not about following laws as a Christian. Right. It's about receiving that grace.
That's the whole message of it, right? It was like I grew up in studying the scripture quite a bit. And so it's interesting because the New Testament's basic concept is, hey, all of those laws, you don't have to follow those anymore. Just love. Like that's the new laws, like love, right? So it's not like love, oh yeah, and you have to cut off the 50% of the boy's skin of his penis when he's born too. That's the way. Like that doesn't make any sense at all. I don't know how. And it's not like the Jews are following all the Levitical laws anyway. It's kind of like a pick and choose.
Yes.
If you want to follow kind of situation at this point. We don't hear a lot about like, hey, your shirt's made from two different fabrics. You can't wear that.
Like, yeah, it's...
But we do have the, oh, but we got to cut off your foreskin. And the crazy thing is that the modern version of that isn't really about the, it's not really, it traces its lineage from the Jewish tradition, but really it's about trying to stop masturbation and a belief that masturbation is wrong somehow and this idea that it caused a lot of diseases. So, I mean, strangely, we can trace, and I wrote about this in my magazine, but we can trace the origins of the modern circumcision movement to this massive anti-masturbation movement that came out of the eugenics community and their belief that masturbation caused all these different diseases, and so they had to stop it. And so the way, and they were circumcising girls at that time too in the United States. I mean, that just ended in the 1970s. So just so you know, girls were being circumcised right up through till when the year you were, what year were you born?
85.
Okay, so just before, I think it was about 79 that Blue Cross stopped paying for female circumcision.
Yeah, it's crazy. There's also the whole, this is a business too.
Yeah.
Which is, I don't know, my mind started even going down a rabbit hole. If this is true that this circumcision, these circumcisions are decreasing the capacity for men to feel empathy. If I know it's, some people would say it's a reach, but there's something about that, and I don't know, because, and then I was talking to someone about this, and their girlfriend's brother was getting enrolled in a military school, and they suggested for him to be circumcised before enrolling. And then my mind started going down a really crazy rabbit hole. I'm like, wait a minute, are they like creating, are we creating an army of unempathetic men? Is this like,
well, we're how about a herd?
Yeah, herd.
Because some of the herd become soldiers, but not all of them, right? So it's more of like a herd. I mean, yeah, my belief is that this is basically a factory farm. And if you trace back the civilization, if you just follow it back, most people don't have the attention span to do it, but it doesn't go back that far. This whole civilization is very, very new, right? We just trace it back to England, and we can trace England back to Rome, and Rome back to Greece, and Greece back to Egypt, and Egypt back to those Assyria and Babylon and those places that were in sort of the Fertile Crescent. And then we can trace it back to Turkey at this place called Göbekli Tepe. This is about 10, 11,000 years ago. That's like the beginning of the modern human epic. It looks like there was a massive cataclysm of some kind, probably a massive worldwide flood that did happen. Then sort of out of that comes Göbekli Tepe. And from that moment on, there has been this tradition of human enslavement. And it's carried on right till today. And today, the human slaves are convinced to think they're free. And so all over, especially here, every morning, you know, as right at the beginning of their dog training session in their kennels called schools, they stand up and pledge allegiance talking about how free they are. Right? Does that make any sense at all? That's what's going on. And so we are a kind of slave who is forced to continue working to produce labor, to produce goods, and to produce taxable income. Right? So we do that. All of us would love not to have to do that, but we can't find any way out of this system because it's a big tricky matrix of enslavement. The whole thing destroys our health and bankrupts us. And at the end, right when we're dead, charges us one more time to put us in the ground formaldehyded as a pickle in a box, right? And then harvests the last of it off. It's insane. And people are just like, no, this is just how it's supposed to be. Like, really? They cut part of your penis off, dude. Wake up, slave.
Well, yeah, and people will defend that, too. They'll defend that. And women will defend it, too.
What is it called when Stockholm Syndrome? That's when you defend your captor when you're the victim of a kidnapping. So you get kidnapped, and at first you just want to get free, and then eventually you start to empathize with the plight of your kidnapper. And by the end of it, sometimes you join their cause or want to protect them. Hmm. That's just something psychological that happens. But
so what's the good news here?
Well, the good news is that we kind of can wake up to this. Yeah, we got to start looking around. Like I wrote pretty extensively in the fourth dispatch of Rewild Yourself on this topic about human slavery. There's a lot of human slavery going on in the world today. Way more than people realize. I mean, it's shocking how much is going on. There's a lot of sex slavery, right? There's a lot of human trafficking going on. There are, have you seen the pygmy people in Africa? Have you seen that?
I don't think so. But
there are hobbit-sized human beings in Africa, parts of Africa. They're literally like little pint-sized people, right? Like a race of humans that are the size of children.
Okay.
Being enslaved, they are working as slaves under regular-sized African people. There are people in the Middle East in these brick kilns who've been enslaved for generations under this. And there's just slavery all over the world. And then there's the big picture slavery, right? Like the kind of slavery we've been part of for a while. We can start to perceive now how it's working. We have enough communication. Like the big thing when you enslave somebody is you don't want them to really get to talk to anybody. The internet's given us this really unique opportunity to like sort of get all the information and pull it all together in one place. I don't know how long we'll have access to this level of information, but right now we can kind of see, we can get the big picture of what's been going on here. And we can also see that, hey, guess what? There's been this whole domestication eugenics program rolled out on us over a pretty long period of time that's been changing our bodies, domesticating us, and convincing us that nature is threatening to us. And the reality is some of us are starting to wake up to that. right? And like, look at you, man, running around the world, hanging out at waterfalls, naked in the sun. This is now an option, right? That was not, that wasn't really an option to, for people that, when I was growing up, very few people would have been able to ever see that option. 10, 20 years ago, man, people wouldn't have known that option existed. So I think there's a lot of good news, but there's a lot of bad news. And the thing about the bad news is that it's not popular to talk about that. And the more you get up to hanging out with the people who are naked in the waterfall, the less they want to talk about that stuff. So I was just writing today on the topic of situational awareness. And I was writing about how there's this whole thing of like, don't talk about anything negative that could happen. You might attract it to happen. That is the stupidest. To me, that is so stupid, right? That doesn't make any sense at all, actually. I want to be aware of possible threats so that I can be protected against those things. And so I can feel confident in my environment. I don't want to like just put, I kind of joke about it in the article I was writing about the Tibetan Buddhist monks, right? Because they got slaughtered by the Chinese, slaughtered, right? Still going on in Tibet. And I'll say, like, to people when they bring that up, I'll say, hey, do those people, did they attract that through their negative thinking? I doubt it. They don't look like they were doing, most of us who are into positive thinking have stolen most of those ideas from the Buddhists. So I'm not thinking they were into negative thinking. Bad things can happen, right? We got to stay aware. And one of the big problems in this kind of spiritual community or the consciousness community, I love that we call it consciousness because it's like, if you're conscious, you're actually aware of your environment. So most people who call themselves conscious aren't really wanting to practice that. But when we start to become aware and conscious, we start to see, hey, there's a lot of really gnarly stuff happening. Stuff that we need to be actively shifting and changing. And trying to pretend it's not going on is not going to be an effective strategy. So anyway, I guess all that comes from the idea of, hey, what's the good news? There is some good news, but we got to stay awake to the bad news. Otherwise, we're not going to be of assistance to anybody. And those predators who've been perpetuating this thing will keep perpetuating it until we shine light on them, right? So when you see something happening that's dark or wrong or evil, you shine light on that. And the sort of darkness wants to flee away from that. But if we act like it's not going on and we just pretend this stuff isn't happening, it's just going to keep happening. And they're going to keep cutting the foreskins off of baby boys. And people are going to continue to be wage slaves. And the rainforest will continue to burn and we'll end up in a dust bowl. Or we get like hip to it. So I don't know. I think we need to get hip to both the good and the bad.
Yeah, we've done a lot of that work on people, specific people internally. We try to help shed the light on when you have something you're fearing or something you don't want to talk about or something, an emotion you keep resisting, it's going to keep persisting. Yeah. But one of the healthiest things that I've found, especially in relationships, is to basically share our resentments in a loving way. It's like one of the most neglected forms of love. Because people that have this idea that we only talk about what's appropriate or let's don't go there, that typically starts haunting at them and their relationship. And now
it's you from the inside.
The what?
It'll destroy you from the inside.
Yeah. And I'm seeing what you're saying as a larger scale of this, as the human population. So how do I go about bringing light to the darkness on Earth? Like I feel like I've been doing a pretty valiant effort and a good effort to do it individually.
I think you're doing a great job, man.
But like this, I don't know anything about this African pygmy slave thing that's going on here. What would you suggest if someone's listening? Like, man, well, Daniel Vitalis is right. I need to bring light to this.
Well, I mean, what I'm saying is we need to become aware. I think what you're doing and talking about for, as an individual, this is an opportunity to do it as an individual. I don't really think, okay, it's like this idea, like I always marvel at this breast cancer awareness campaign that's going on, for instance, right? The pink ribbon thing, like.
Mm-hmm. Buy a bucket of KFC.
Buy a bucket of KFC, mm-hmm. You walk around a track, walk a 5K for breast cancer, right? And not, hey, change your life to bulletproof yourself against breast cancer, which would be the solution on an individual level. Instead, people who are giving themselves breast cancer are running around trying to raise awareness about it. This is just absolutely absurd. We need to change ourselves, right? So I do think it begins at an individual level and doing the kind of work you're doing with individuals because, man, when you sit down with a person and or a group of people and you see change happen in them, right? They actually internalize and anchor that change. then you're making ripples into the world, because those people go out and they repeat that work and repeat that work and repeat that work. So I'm not trying to add a burden of like, oh my God, you got to go save the pygmies. What I'm saying, somebody will, hopefully, maybe not, I don't know. What we can do is change ourselves and start to emancipate ourselves, internally emancipate ourselves. And that means we have to like dig deep in ourselves and be honest about where we feel enslaved inside ourselves. And that's what people have a really hard time doing. And so there's all, because society, through its really clever psychological games, has imprinted taboo around every aspect of your slavery that's obvious. So when it's your sexuality, when it's your relationship to drugs, when it's how you move, when it's your clothing, when it's stuff around family, when it's these stupid holiday traditions, when it's shopping and Black Friday, like all this stuff that we all instinctively know is like kind of twisted and demented, but we play along with it because it's too taboo to confront it. That's the stuff that's like, ding, 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 I need to look at that. I need to shine light on that. I need to be honest with myself, like really honest with myself and start from there. People are afraid to even, I've been bringing up a lot in the last few months, and it's been awesome to watch the response. I've been bringing up the topic of monogamy as a default setting for relationships. And boy, does that get people just flipping their wigs, right? And what's so interesting about it is like, I'm super open on this topic. Like I have a largely monogamous relationship I've been in for a long time and really am happy in that relationship. I'm not saying people shouldn't have monogamous relationships. I'm saying, hey, let's explore whether this is what's actually innate for us or not. People flip out often before they'll even begin to ask the question. So I'll be like, what's so threatening about the question? Like, if you're so sure that you're happy this way, then why are you so threatened by the question? You know what I mean? That doesn't make any sense. If I say like, Danimal, everybody should tattoo their face. You're not going to be like, hey, shut up, man. I don't have to. Why would I ever do that? I don't have to do that. It doesn't make any sense. Bro. You'd be like, dude, I'm so sure that everybody does. I'm not threatened by that question. But when you bring up something like nakedness, or you bring up the ethical and healthy use of drugs, or you bring up stuff around sex, people flip out because there's something there that they're not looking at, obviously, or they wouldn't care, right? You don't. If I tell you the sun isn't going to rise tomorrow, are you going to freak out at me and be like, yes, it is, man. It totally is, bro.
No, I can totally empathize with this idea because, once again, the retreats that we do, when a trigger point happens, we know this is something we need to look at.
We found it.
Yeah, this is – I know you might not want to hear it right now, but let's stay open to there might be an ounce or more of truth here.
Totally. I want to spend most of my work in the world, most of my time and energy in the world on this stuff that's the triggers. What else is there? It's like we already – all the other stuff's like been explored, man. It's all good. Like, yeah, we all love massages and rainbows, and we all love like feeling good and singing Kumbaya around the fire. It's all great. I love all that stuff. But what about all this stuff in the dark that we need to shine light on, because we're never going to be free until we do? What's lurking in those shadows? And the thing is you know how there's that thing, if like in the shadows, something really small can appear really big sometimes. Like if it's shadows cast upon the wall and it can feel like a giant monster, and then you light it up and it's like, oh, it's a mouse. That's how most of this stuff is. You know what I mean? It's like around this idea of monogamy, for instance, it's like, it's just a little mouse there to look at, but everyone's so freaked out that it's a giant beast of a thing that's going to tear their lives apart that they'd rather not look like what monster might be in the closet, right? And it's actually just a coat.
Man, we find that, like, specifically, for instance, jealousy. Find that so much that people are so scared to admit of jealousy that they'll come up with any other explanation that's, like, torturous to almost listen to. They'll get angry. They'll start condemning people. They'll start finding – like, you'll find someone that's doing great work. We both interviewed Ido Portal. You'll find a guy like Ido Portal, who's one of the best movers in the world, but you'll find some people that are so unwilling to admit their jealousy that they'll find anything wrong with this guy. That guy's a jerk. Like, he's not even that good at doing flips. Like, they'll find all the flaws. And like, what are you talking about? Like, where did this even come from? Instead of, sometimes it just takes like, man, when I'm around you, I get insecure or I'm jealous. And all of a sudden, it's like you feel so free and liberated.
And it's so easy, right? It's so easy. I have a real, like, one of my best friends out there. I don't think he ever watches my stuff, but if he did, he'll know I'm talking about him. We, from the moment we met each other, it was like, whoa, we're like the same dude almost. We had like the same clothes. We met each other both walking around in Thai fisherman pants with a didgeridoo. I mean, what are the chances of that? It was like, really? You have a didgeridoo in your hand and the same pants as me? And we were just all through, we compete and vie without even trying to. Just the nature of our energies together, it's like, we're so inspired, but he makes me so insecure. Right? When I see him, it's so great for a couple of weeks, and then it's like, man, I'm starting to get really stressed out, actually.
Or if I could offer, you make yourself very insecure around him.
Yeah, thank you. And eventually it's like we'll take space from each other, and I'll like recover from that intense emotion, and it's like, what bothers me is I see him doing things that I love and he does them well and I want to do them well, and I start to worry that he's somehow doing them better than me and then my value is diminishing or something like that. And obviously that's not happening at all. And what's funny is he's feeling the same way, right? And it's like when we finally spoke to each other about that, it was like, so relaxing, because I was walking around with a complex about it, you know, all the time. And I find that all the time. So it's like, you know, Ida Portel, beautiful man, right? That's the bottom line. Beautiful man, incredibly talented, capable of some really epic movement. So I get what you're saying, is a lot of guys will see somebody like that and be like, yeah, whatever. He's such a show off.
It's like amazing what people come up with.
You would love to be able to do what he's doing. And the fact that he's pursued that can be hard to see if you're not able to admit that to yourself. At the same time, Ido Portel might feel that way about you in another area that you've pursued. I think one of the challenges as a guy, I can't speak for what it's like to be a woman on this planet, but as a guy, I want to do everything and master everything. Literally everything. Like, just the amount of projects I have underway is so overwhelming sometimes because I want to do everything. And because I'm not a specialist, my kind of philosophy is I can get to be in the top tier of everything, but I'm probably not going to be number one at a whole bunch of things because that takes specific focus. And I'm trying to do a lot of things, right? So if I can be a great runner and a great swimmer and a great lifter and I can be great at martial arts and I can do all these things, but I'm not going to be the champion in all of those things. Nobody can be that, right? So I have to accept that there's going to be these people who are going to be the best, and just that I don't have to get triggered by that. I can be inspired by that. You know what I'm saying? But it, you know, whatever.
And I agree. And I think one of the best ways to turn that trigger into respect, or that obstacle into an opportunity, is to talk about it, to bring light to it. And that's sometimes I surround myself with, I would say, a very advanced level of people. What they're doing, they're some of the best at. Even here, I'm with my friend. I'm at my friend JP's house, and he's like, I don't know many people. He does psychological help for people that are psychologists. And so obviously when I'm around him and we're talking about our emotions, sometimes I get a little jealous of how he can convey things and articulate them so well. And I want to really hold myself accountable to express that jealousy when it happens, because I want to make sure I remain in a respectful position, rather than like, I'll start coming up with passive aggressive ways to bring him down. And that's not what I want.
Yeah, totally. Well, thanks for saying that, because again, I mean, I can't speak for women, but as a man, there's this cultural thing about this machismo, where it's like, one, to admit another man is just great at something is like already culturally taboo. And then to be able to admit that you feel that way is like, most guys are not going to be able to go there. And you connected to earlier that circumcision plays a piece in this, or could be. So there is some like preliminary evidence that men who've been circumcised cut off from their emotions and have a difficulty expressing emotions that uncircumcised men have an easier time with. But of course, we see that even uncircumcised men just living in this culture, there's a lot of factors. So it's not just that, but there are a lot of factors that cause us to run away from being able to even communicate about these things. So big ups, man, because the man of the new paradigm, the man of the future, is somebody who can talk about how he feels and not be threatened by it, right? It's like, for you to admit that is like not, and to talk about it only makes you stronger and more confident. You know, it's really interesting. It's like, I study all these survival things, right? Like, that's a big passion of mine. So I'm constantly looking at potential threats that exist. And as I said before, a lot of people get really afraid to do that. So for instance, when there's any example, let's say a mugging, that happens in the world, right? People get mugged, that can happen. So the average person that I know doesn't want to look at that, doesn't want to learn about it, doesn't want to learn how to prevent it, doesn't learn about, want to learn about what to do if it happens to them. They'd rather go, as long as I just stay positive, that can't happen to me. And they think that I'm paranoid by looking at it. But when I look at them, what I see is, no, you're afraid. And it shows under the veneer, just like when somebody's jealous and you can see it from the outside and it's kind of painful, like, ooh, it's kind of obvious. They're trying to cover it. I see that with people all the time. Like, they're afraid of stuff and they act like I'm being paranoid, but it's like, I'm not paranoid. I'm super confident. I'm so confident around, for instance, the idea of being mugged. I feel so confident around that. One, I know how to avoid that. Two, I know what to do, or at least have some plans on how to deal with that should that ever happen to me. Three, I understand what kind of person does that and why, so I know how to be able to spot that before it even happens. So I feel totally confident about that, but an average person feels really afraid, and it will restrict what they can do in this life and where they can go. So similarly, if you're somebody who's dealing with all this jealousy, think about all the wonderful people. Like, you know, you can't have these kind of wonderful friends. You'd feel too threatened.
Yep.
You want to have the best people around, you know?
Yeah, another friend that I feel insecure around sometimes, my friend Brandon Hawk, he brings this idea to his conferences about, for a change to take place, you first need an awareness, then you need an acceptance, and then you can take action. And so many people try to take action without having accepting the situation. And I hear that a lot with what you're saying. And I also don't necessarily agree with everything you say. And I love that we can still talk. I can still be present with you, even though I don't agree with everything you say, and I imagine you're the same way. I imagine you look for people that challenge your current beliefs.
I mean, everybody challenges my beliefs to some degree, right? I don't know. I don't have anybody in my life who's like, wow, we agree 100% on every single thing. Yeah, absolutely not. And obviously, the more – well, not obviously, but for me, the more I work through this life and find higher calibers of – I don't say higher caliber of people, but people who've explored more of their – themselves and who have activated more of themselves, the more diverse everybody gets, you know, because I think with thinking poverty of spirit, poverty of.
Okay. You broke up for a second when you said, I think with, and then you broke up.
I'll just kind of start that over. But what I noticed, because I grew up kind of street level, really poor, and the people around me were really poor and, kind of like hungry ghosts, you know what I mean? They're like just this addicted kind of chronically broke and busted up kind of spiritually bankrupt world that I grew up in. And there isn't that much diversity of people in that world because there's like a codependency. So everybody knows like don't change too much because you might not fit in anymore. We all need each other to stay alive. And as I've developed myself more, I've attracted more people who are more developed, and suddenly there's this huge range of diversity. So that in the kind of places where you and I have intersected, everybody is like this unique character, right? It's like a circus sideshow. Everybody's got their kind of thing, and they're all really different. I think that's so wonderful. So yeah, that feels really good. I don't need you to agree with me to validate how I feel about the things that I feel.
Yeah, right back at you. Now, I'm just so happy that I've figured out a way to be surrounded by people that I don't agree with and that I can communicate with and be present even though that we don't agree on everything. I mean, I just find so much more growth personally when I surround myself with people that I can make connections based on what we disagree about and being present through those trigger points or being present through those reflections. And I definitely honor you for the same thing. I know we're coming up in about an hour here. So maybe I'll just bring up some big topics and you can give me some quick answers. Maybe I'll reel people in to go check out more of what you're doing on your podcast and websites because I think it's information that the world is starving for. What about this? I think you were on someone else's podcast, but you had some about employees and capitalism and these phrases. Are you able to give like a quick summary of how you see that system set up?
Yeah, well, our system's called capitalism, and capita means head, and it's headism, and most people have heard this idea of we count like cattle by head of cattle. So capitalism comes from the idea of how many cattle do you have, And therefore, the more you have, the higher ranking you are. And this all comes out of the domestication process. So we human beings used to live in egalitarian civilizations. There's really not any debate about that. Whether you come from like a from a religious background, or you come from a scientific background, or some hybrid of these things, everybody kind of agrees that at one point we were all really egalitarian. And then the system changes and we go into this capitalist world. Now, what's interesting to me is we count humans per capita as well. So there's this idea of human cattle or chattel. It's another word for it. And we have a system where you get a job, and to get that job is to be employed. And of course, the word ploy is a cleverly designed trick or scheme designed to get advantage over you. And the word N or M, those are prefix words. They mean the same thing: to go into, to be put into, to willingly put oneself into. So when we get a job and we become employed, we are going into a scheme cleverly designed to gain advantage over us. And when we have an employer, the employer is the one who's used the ploy, and the employee is the one who has the ploy played on them. So essentially what's going on is we're working in this. I guess if I was going to really break it down, here's the unfortunate thing about capitalism. And we're in a time now where it's really popular to talk about like new paradigm capitalism, spiritual commerce, or all these kind of things. I don't really think this is the reality for me personally, even though I participate in it because I have to survive this world. I don't think it's like this great thing and I don't want to venerate it, but essentially human beings we're social animals. So to take a social animal and make it compete with every other individual for resources is the most toxic thing you could do to it, right? To take a social animal and make them work against each other is how you divide and conquer that group. Because naturally, look, if I drop, you know, let's say I drop 15 of us on an island, right? And there'd be a great waterfall there. You'd love it. If we were all on that island, we were like, okay, we're gonna live here, man. No resources are coming. Nobody's coming for us. Are we going to set up a capitalist society where we compete against each other over resources? No way. We would naturally just be like, okay, dude, you're best at this, you're best at this. I'll do the fire tonight. You keep watch. Hey, let's get a boat together. We're going to start doing things together. And no one's going to expect payment in the form of money for that. And certainly we're not going to be like, we need to set up a central bank that takes a percentage of every transaction we do. But this is not natural for us. The fact that the way that the system's set up is it's a ploy and we're all employed by it. And its goal is to divide, conquer, tax, and enslave us. And what I'm really bothered by right now is just all the wonderful, brilliant entrepreneurs out there who don't see that and who are talking about capitalism like it's this wonderful thing. And I think we need to get really real about this. But again, there's a lot of taboo, and it's just one of those areas where people don't want to really explore it because it's too scary to them.
So, I mean, so when you allude to this idea of we need to get really real with these entrepreneurs, what do you mean by that?
As entrepreneurs. So I'm not going to name names because I respect a lot of the people who are out there. But I'm sure you kind of know the type of archetype I'm talking about, the person who's made their career online and then maybe teaches people how to build a career online. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea is conscious capitalism, right? That's just a really popular kind of buzz term right now. I think if we all check in with our hearts, man, I think it's pretty universal. If I check in with my heart, I don't feel good about how our system works. I feel good, dude. If you and I transact money together, I can feel good, but I feel good about doing something with you. I don't feel good about this whole monetary system that we're a part of. And I don't feel good about having to use usury to take a percentage of your thing or trying to figure out who's this. That doesn't feel good. That's just the beast that we're in, right? That's like Babylon. But I think again, we got to get real. Just like, again, like you might, for me, if I get really real about relationship stuff, if I get really real about it, the main reason to want monogamy is so my partner never does anything that could make me jealous. That'd be my main reason. Not because I don't want to do it. I don't want to ever be with another person. That wouldn't be my reason. If I get real with myself. Now, admitting that doesn't mean I have to change my relationship, right? It just means be honest. If I get honest with myself, I would love to be able to have you know, sort of whatever partners I want to have, but I would love to keep my partner from being able to do that. That's the reality of a lot of people I talk to. Similarly, I can admit that without having to go do anything about it. I can just get real with it, right?
I think you admitting it will make it less likely of you acting on it.
Yes, exactly, right? Because people are all acting on that already, but pretending they're not, and it's all fraught with lies and blah, blah, blah. I can admit circumcision doesn't feel right to me without having to, I don't know, get a surgical added on foreskin. I don't have to do anything about it. I can just admit it. Similarly, I can admit that I don't like having to sell stuff to people, and I don't like having to buy stuff from people. I would way rather us all work together in some kind of way that's natural to us. I can admit that without having to shut my business down. You know what I'm saying? So there's this weird thing where everyone wants to pretend like this is this great thing going on, and what we don't want to pay attention to are the strip mines in China where all the stuff's coming from, right? Or the factories where kids are enslaved to produce the goods that we're all acting like are so great, or we're all acting like our iPhones are this wonderful thing that allow us to do all this. Like, it's great, dude. I can be at a waterfall, and you know, I can be in the desert, and we can be doing all these wonderful things. But there are slaves making these phones for us that we're using to communicate about it, and that's happening in the darkness over here, and nobody wants to look at that, right?
I definitely want to look at, because sometimes I feel like I'm a slave to this.
Yeah, well, and again, man, I mean, flip that thing around. Show it to us again on the back. Isn't that what Eve took a bite out of? It's got the bite mark that she took, bro. It's like they put it right on there. It's the knowledge of good and evil. That's the mythology of our culture. It's the idea that the forbidden fruit that gave us knowledge of everything, good and evil, and that literally has become the symbol that's now dominating the minds of our culture. It's a meme, man. It's right in our faces, and people are like blind to it. So anyway, I just think it's really interesting. We are we're participating in a system that is antithetical to our nature, and then we're going to pretend, like Stockholm Syndrome, that we support that system. That's demented.
Yeah, this I hear you're bringing a lot of awareness to ideas. We're not going deep into each one, but I don't see a problem with awareness. I see awareness as like being a form of light.
Yeah,
and not kind of scary sometimes, you know, that you can be in a cave surrounded by tigers, and it might not be scary until you see them. But then you can act on it.
You don't have to do more to like. What's interesting is you're taking in all of this data all the time. So one of the challenges is like, if I start saying like, "Oh, dude, saunas are awesome. You got to do saunas. They detoxify you." Blah blah blah. Some people are like, "Man, he's adding another thing. I'm already doing so many things. Like, that's one more thing I got to do." And I get that. So sometimes it's like, "I don't want to know anything more because I don't want to have to do anything more because it's hard to fit it all in." Get that. With being aware or conscious of things, you don't have to do anything more. You have to do something less. It's like one less thing you have to do, one less thing you're filtering out. So all you're doing is opening the aperture of your sensory gating systems to allow more data to filter into your conscious mind. You don't have to like go around like looking for more stuff. It's already right in front of us. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's just simply allowing that light in instead of doing the actual work of resisting. Because like you said before, if I resist what I brought up about relationships before, I'm actually doing something, and that's going to cause a pathological expression somewhere else. So if I block out stuff, man, it's a surefire way to have more problems created. So yeah, I'm just suggesting people allow their natural conclusions to arise instead of fighting them.
And that being said, I'm feeling this is like a pretty good introduction if people haven't heard of you. How does this video, what's the best way to get these podcasts and videos spread if someone's listening to this and they want to bring awareness to other friends? They want to open up some gateways or rabbit holes to their friends' minds or their family's minds.
Well, pose that question another way. I've not ever heard that question. Say it again.
Basically, what's the best way to bring more awareness to this interview right now? I know you have a call to action at the end of your videos. The podcasting world is relatively new to me compared to you. What's the best way?
Here's what we want people to do. Okay, so this is on iTunes, the podcast.
Yeah, it'll be both. It'll be a YouTube video and a podcast.
So what we want people to do is, if they enjoyed the conversation, then definitely let other people know about it, for one, because podcasts are great, right? Because you can just listen to them while you do other things. It's like you have friends around as we all live in our little isolated technological bubbles. It's quite nice. So that's one. Share it. Leave a really good comment if you liked it so people know that they, hey, if they stumble upon this, that it's worth their time off, and we'll read to see what other people are thinking of something. So rate it well if you like it, and subscribe to the, what's the name of this podcast?
RawBrahs.
Right on. So subscribe to it because, yeah, that way you can stay abreast of other things that Daniel's talking about. So those would be my call to actions.
Yeah, and right back to you. And how do they find you one last time?
Yeah, they find me at danielvitalis.com, and I would recommend people sign up for my newsletter because that will get them free access to my magazine, of which there are currently six dispatches out, and they're really rich with content. Also, they can go to iTunes and find Rewild Yourself, my podcast there, and subscribe to that. So, yeah, and endless other things. You find me all over the internet.
Yeah, thanks, man. Thanks for everything. Thanks for bringing so much light to so many shadows. And thanks. I got to hang out with you at the Bulletproof Conference, and that was definitely fun. One of the first things I did when we met you, we just started rolling around, which I really – actually, I've been practicing some of those rolls and flips. And
Oh, man, on a personal level, if you get an opportunity ever to study with MoveNat, I just got back from three certifications with them. So I did about a week-long immersive thing with them. To become a MoveNat trainer. But if you're not familiar with their work, I would check that out, especially if you like Ido Portel stuff. These guys are doing some really cool stuff, and you can go take a weekend training and come out with a really awesome movement skill set that might be new to you.
Yeah, there was a guy that came on one of our retreats. He has a thing called Strength Box in Canada, and he was MoveNat certified. So that is something that's been on the radar for a while now.
Really worth it. I had a great time with Erwan Lacour and his crew. So anyway, really cool people to check out.
Awesome. And I also noticed how, just on a funny note, you were really quick when I was you were getting a tour of the house you were staying. This guy moves like a little ninja. That's pretty impressive. Have you always moved that way, just on a random side note?
No, I grew up like a kind of a fat kid who didn't really do anything. And but I think as we develop our movement style, our unique movement style. Each of us has different strengths and sort of areas where we really shine. And because I have such a small body type, as I've developed my style, that's one of the attributes that I have. I certainly didn't. Born like that. That's right.
It was just something that stuck out to me. We were like, he was giving a tour of the place, and then we were in one room, and then I would turn my head to like say something to Diana, and then all of a sudden you were in the next room. I'm like, where'd he go? He's a magician here.
Yeah, well, that ninja thing. I've always loved to train that way. So I have trained in ninjutsu, and the MoveNat thing is very parkour like, and actually came out of the parkour movement to some level. So that whole idea of being able to move through environments like that. I'm just so motivated when I see wild animals, man. Squirrels motivate me, probably inspire me more than any other creature when I watch how they move. And so, yeah, squirreling around a house is like one of my favorite things.
I love to dolphin around the ocean, so I think we have that cool in common.
That's next on my radar is relearning. Man, I know we're at the end of your podcast, but I'm still talking. So, one of the things we did in MoveNat that was really exciting was learning human running again. Being taught properly how to run. And one of the things I found out was that, I've been a runner for a lot of years, but not efficiently, and could certainly have run a lot further with less energy had I known how to run properly. And I'm really excited to do the same thing with swimming. So there's some aquatics classes I'm really looking forward to taking to learn how to move through the water a little more effectively as well.
Yeah, man. We should all hang out again. My youngest brother, he became the state champion swimmer in Georgia. He is, if you're ever interested, especially in sprinting.
Yeah.
The kid's a beast. He's a shark.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah. He moves through the water. I mean, I think if he came upon a philosophy that was pretty debilitating to his career was like, do I really want to dedicate my whole life to swimming across the pool faster than anyone else? And when someone has a question like that, that's kind of, in a way, a career-ending question. It's like, well, that's a good question. But yeah, he had the ability to be an Olympic level swimmer for sure. And wow. Still does, probably.
I swim in the ocean a lot.
He, not him as much. My Timothy and I, we definitely spend a good bit of time in the ocean on a surfboard too. I'm a huge fan of like diving deep in cold water and surfing. Yeah. I just love, I mean, it's like the ultimate connection. You're immersed in the ocean. You have the sun shining on you. You're in the wild. It's like the quickest way to the wilderness is like, if some people are like, oh, I can't get the wilderness. If you're near a coastline, go 20 yards off the beach, you're in the wilderness.
Yeah, or people are always like talking about getting grounded, electrically grounded, right? Do I go barefooting? I want to get grounded. It's like get in the ocean. You're, hey man, you should come up to Maine and surf sometime. We've got waves.
Yeah, I'm actually in Charleston right now, and they just had some swell. They had a swell here. It was awesome. Maine, I'll probably have no shortage of cold water there.
Yeah, you need like 7 mils of wetsuit, but it's a but we surf up here, man. It's doable.
Oh yeah, I went. Maine is like the. I think I've been to about. I have like 4 or 5 states that I have not been to in the United States, and that's one of them.
So, oh man, you have to come up sometime. I'd love to have you up here.
For sure, we'll stay in touch about that. And once again, thanks a lot. And man, yeah, we'll be in touch soon.
Thanks, Daniel.
All right, peace.